Hello everybody, good morning and welcome to the United Stand. This is your latest Manchester United news and we've got quite a big transfer update for you this morning involving a centre-back that Manchester United have been linked to, and it's coming from a good source as well. It's coming from David Ornstein from The Athletic. But before I get into that, I just want to say we are sponsored our morning show by Flick, which is an app which has basically got the United Stand on there. For all of you lot to get involved in the community, you can chat away 24/7. There are quizzes, there are polls. There is a poll on there that's just gone up this morning actually. Which centre back would you prefer at Manchester United? David Alaba, Carmo, or Upamecano? I've cast my vote, and at the moment, my vote is the person I've chosen has got 67% of the vote. But you can check that out. Links in the video description. It's free on Android and on Apple as well. James Hooman, welcome to the Members Club. So I've got lots to talk about this morning, and I've got quite a big message I want to talk about as well in relation to this constant media issue that we've got with Mason Greenwood and Marcus Rashford, Paul Pogba, Man United players in general, really, and the hypocrisy that I believe comes from the media and the football club itself. But we'll talk about that in a bit. Let's talk off a bit of this big news because it is the morning show. So David Carmo is a player we were talking about on Friday night with regards to Zagadou from Dortmund as well. And Manchester United being linked to both 21, both over 6 foot, both left-footed centre-backs that Manchester United may well be looking at as well. So this is from David Ornstein this morning, who was formerly of the BBC, now works for The Athletic. Very, very good journalist. And what he had to say is that Manchester United have been linked with David Carmo, but if they want to sign him, they're going to face stiff competition from other clubs. Up to 10 clubs have spoken to Carmo's representatives, one of those being Manchester United's rivals in the top six. He also goes on to say that Carmo has been likened to Virgil van Dijk for his ability on the ball and his defensive prowess. He doesn't actually mention Manchester United. He says Manchester United rivals. Are Manchester United one of those clubs in that 10 looking at David Carmo? Well, he's 21. He's 6 foot five. He's left footed. I've not seen loads of him, and I must admit, I had a look this morning, and I hate to admit this, but I had a look this morning at quite a few articles about him, not ones in the last few days, because you get loads of people write about a player when United get linked to him. I've been looking at like Scout Report articles going back over the last 6 months, really, because he only actually made his debut for Braga in January. So he's, you know, he only started playing for Braga when we signed Bruno. So not very often, he's not very been there that often. And the thing that resonates about Carmo is that there's massive potential there. And Roma, in fact, wanted to buy him in the summer. But there's two things I would say. One, very, very good on the ball and left-footed. Very confident at playing the ball out from the back, whether it's 50-yard passes or 5-yard passes. He's a ball-playing centre-back. So that's a positive. Very, very good in the air. He's 6 foot five. The question is, is he more of a Harry Maguire backup than a Harry Maguire partner? Because he's not slow. He's quicker than Maguire, but he's not Twansebi fast. I just think he looks like a Harry Maguire backup and not a Harry Maguire partner, because Harry Maguire this season, I think he's in the top five again for aerial duels in Europe. Now, Harry Maguire has had a lot of criticism this season, but aerially, when it comes to aerial duels, we're not talking about the amount of headers he misses when he wins them from corners, because he does win a lot of corner crosses that Bruno puts in or Mata puts in. Just doesn't score as many as we'd like, but he has started scoring this season, which is good. But his aerial prowess is fantastic. So why would you buy David Carmo, who's 6 foot five, not particularly fast, although he's quicker than Maguire, and play him left-sided centre-back and Harry Maguire right-sided centre-back? Yet again, you've got no synergy. You've got two absolute, you know, giraffes as centre-backs, but you don't have complementary skills. You know, Maguire's pretty good on the ball, really. He'd be better on the right side because he's right-footed. So I like the look of David Carmo, and I think he looks like a good player, but I must admit, and I'm going to be honest, because everyone will be really positive, because it's, oh, we're linked to a player. From what I've seen of him, I like him. But I don't see him and Maguire playing together because they're ridiculously similar. They're both very tall. They're both good. Well, I think Carmo's probably better on the ball than Maguire. But it's not, I think we all know the centre-back that we need to play next to Harry Maguire is somebody who is quick who can be good in the air, who is good on the ball, but, you know, probably someone who's about 6 foot, 6 foot two, that sort of, not we don't need another tower like Harry Maguire. We need somebody who's a bit pacey. So I do like the look of him. I think he's an interesting player, and it'll be very interesting if Manchester United do make a move for him. But his release clause is, he signed a new contract in the summer, I think, and his release clause has gone up from 18 million euro to about 36 million euros, so it's doubled. So he'd cost about 30 million quid. But it's interesting that Manchester United are looking at or linked to that sort of a player, and we certainly do need a centre-back. And look, to be honest with you, if I'm absolutely honest, of course I'd prefer David Alaba at 28 or Upamecano, because I think that they are more the profile of centre-back that we need. They're that little bit quicker. They're obviously more experienced, the pair of them. They're probably more talented at this stage in their career. And I think with David Carmo as well, and the big thing I would say about him is you buy him and he becomes another Pelestri. He becomes another Ahmed Diallo. You know, somebody that's potentially really good that we've got to wait for, and we need somebody to come in and play now. And I think with Upamecano or David Alaba, you get somebody who comes in and plays now. Do you think Liverpool, if they go and buy a centre-back in January, are going to buy somebody for the future when they need somebody now to help them try and get into a title race now? And I think United, we're always talking about the bloody future. Everything's always about the future. We're on the right track. We're committed to the long-term plan. But the long-term plan becomes a very long-term plan when it's always a long-term plan. I mean, let's not forget, Ole Gunnar Solskjaer has been at this club for 2 years in a month's time. And yet we're still talking about a long-term plan. We need a now. And then a long-term plan contradicts the signings of people like Cavani, who won't be here in the long term, and Matic and Mata. We've got players for now that we need to add to. We can't always keep talking about in the future, because if you buy Carmo and he's ready in 18 months, and Diallo is ready in 18 months, and Pelestri is ready in 18 months, well, you might solve your centre-back problems and your wing problems, but in 18 months, Matic won't be here anymore, Mata won't be here anymore, Cavani won't be here anymore. I think Manchester United's problem is we're always planning for the future, and we need to be a little bit more clever than that. Like the video, says Seda, thank you very much. And Carmo can play CDM as well, says Amit. Well, I've got to be honest with you, I would never want a centre defensive midfielder who's 6'5". The only one I can think of was Nzonzi, who used to play at Stoke and then went to, I think he went to Sevilla. I don't want a 6'5" centre defensive midfielder. So crack on if that you think that's a good idea, but not for me. Mark, like, share and subscribe, says Vandy Candy. And a few people just having a chat. Thanks for the contribution there from Alexander. Does David Carmo play in the Portuguese national team, says Connie Nilsson. Not quite yet. I don't think it will be particularly long. He has been part of the Portuguese setup in the youth setups, and he was part of the team that I think they won the under-19 European Championships or something like that. So he has played there. If Man United want Carmo, we can't him because our incompetent board will back out since there will be competitions, as Ronit Biswas. I think that's a very good point as well. I don't think that we would be able to get hold of him because of that either. I think that because he's a player that's I'm losing my mind here. I think you're right. I think when there is competition for places, Manchester United can sometimes be a little bit, well, they don't normally get deals. And if David Ornstein's right, and there's 10 clubs apparently talking to David Carmo's representatives, that says two things to me. One, he's a very, sought after player. And two, forget about it with United. What I'm basically saying here is David Carmo looks like a good signing. And if we sign him, then that's great. But I don't think we're going to get him. I don't think he is the profile of player that United are going to go for. He's, you know, there's a lot of competition for him. And unfortunately, it feels to me like there are a lot of clubs that want centre-backs around Europe at the moment. There's quite a few in England, and there's obviously quite a few in Europe. And unfortunately for Manchester United, we don't really operate that well unless we've got a clean run at somebody. You think about the opportunity we really messed up on. Let's be absolutely honest. The one we messed up on was Harry Maguire, because we spent a lot of money on Harry. And it's not his fault, I'm not saying that, but we had a clear run at Harry Maguire, and there was a few other centre-backs at that point that other clubs weren't looking to buy. I think right now there's a lot of clubs looking to buy centre-backs, and what are we going to get? You you know, Alaba's available, will we get Alaba? Upamecano's available, will we get Upamecano? David Carmo's available, will we get him? If you don't get any of those three, where do you go next? I mean, there are other centre-backs out there, of course there are, but, you know, United need to be getting one of those three for sure. Mark, I've seen some footage and heard that Carmo massively lacks in pace. Two slow giants at centre-back in Carmo and Maguire still exposes lack of pace at the back, says Shuddy. He's not a slow player. He's not a slow player, but he's not a fast player either. He'd be quicker than Maguire. Would he be much quicker than a Victor Lindelof? I'm not convinced. I mean, look, you don't really get many 6'5" speedsters, to be honest with you. Although, what's his name? Was Bolt was quite tall, wasn't he? How tall was Usain Bolt? We need a Laporte kind of defender who fits that. Alaba, says Sharath Kamath Fitness. Yeah, I think Alaba's the one I would be trying to get. And look, if you are, like Prometheus TV says, if you are looking for a player that is more, what's the word, you know, can play in a number of positions, then look, Alaba can. But I'd be building my defence around David Alaba if I bought him. I wouldn't want him to be playing at centre-back. Alexander says, I've just ordered my green Goldbridge Christmas sweater. Thanks, pal. Links in the video description for that if you want to get your Christmas jumpers. The green one is the best. I just can't wear it on screen because I'll disappear because of the green screen. So there you go. Your same Bolt was 5'7", says Sam Popper. He looked a lot bigger than that. He was 6'5", says Arham. Exactly. There you go. Erling Haaland is 6'4", though, says Simon B. Look, there's always exceptions to the rule. That's why I'm talking about Usain Bolt. He's the quickest guy ever lived at 6'5". But generally, tall people aren't as quick as smaller people when it comes to football. And look, we're not talking about burning pace in football, are we? We're talking about agility. That's what we're talking about. And smaller people are more agile than taller people. Can you imagine Lionel Messi being as good at 6'5"? As he is at, what, 5'7" or whatever he is. So, you know, football speed, I think people get lost in speed. You can get lost in space and you can get lost in speed. I think people get lost in speed because they think, well, you know, such and such is 6'4" and he's a CDM. I think agility is, you know, you look at Fred. Fred's not 6 foot, is he? But he's the best player we've got that's agility, covering the distance quickly, biting into the tackle, low centre of gravity, grabby. You know, that's the sort of player you want as a CDM in my mind. Pallister was rapid. Maybe we can get him back, says Robert McCormack. Gary Pallister was about 6'4", and he used to play right back sometimes for England. Can you say happy birthday to me? I'm 21 today, says Jay Perriman. Yes, we can. And Tillemans would be a great addition to our midfield. Thoughts on that, Mark, says James Churchill. We could have got Tillemans. I think sometimes he plays really well and sometimes he disappears a bit, but he's a good player. He is a good player. One thing I did want to talk about this morning, actually, and I think it's very, very important. Mason Greenwood's back training. I don't know whether he was training last week, but he's definitely training this week. Training pictures of him training yesterday with Manchester United. Obviously not part of the international group. We don't know what's happening with Marcus Rashford. We do know what's happening off the pitch. He's now started a new... what do they call it? New project. Obviously, his previous one was about, you know, feeding children who live in poverty. Now it's about reading for children who, you know, don't have access to books and everything like that. And basically, Marcus Rashford's doing this is because he's come from a poor background himself, and he admits that, and he wants to give as many young people opportunities that he didn't get, who maybe can't afford those opportunities. So Rashford goes from one fantastic project to another in a footballing sense. And obviously he must be applauded for that. I'm going to come back to that in a minute. In a footballing sense, we don't know what happens. Books for children now, says Ockle. That's it. We don't know what Marcus Rashford's fitness is. We'll know later on in the week. But I'm going to say something here, and it's been bubbling away with me for quite a while. I actually wonder where the lack of mainstream media and Manchester United support for Mason Greenwood and Marcus Rashford is. Marcus Rashford gets loads and loads of support in the press for what he's doing. But at the weekend, you get this silly article about how many houses he's bought. And as I said, the British press have this knack of building somebody up and then trying to knock them down. Mason Greenwood has been, you know, treated appallingly over the last few weeks. You know, pretty good journalists. Look, I'm not going to name them. That's not my style when it comes to this. But pretty good journalists have been leaking information about Mason Greenwood being late to training, problematic, might not get a new contract. So let's stick on Greenwood for a moment, because the only people I really see sticking by Mason Greenwood over the last couple of weeks is you, the fans of Manchester United. I'm not convinced the club have done enough, and I'll talk about why in a minute. But I have seen a lot of people who definitely will get information from the club. I'm not saying about Mason Greenwood. They'll get access to press conferences, free tickets to go on tour and things like this. They'll also get little bits of information that the club want to put out about transfers. Those same journalists and outlets have been putting information out about Mason Greenwood. Now, a lot of you have quite rightly, and we've been speaking about it on this channel, this is an 18-year-old lad, I think he's just 19 now, going through a very difficult period in his life. It's well known that a friend of his took their own life a few weeks ago. It's well known that we're in a lockdown. It's well known he's not in a relationship. So he's also a young lad who wants to be doing what young lads are doing, which is what happened in Iceland, as we know. Where's the support network from our press in this country and from our journalists about a young player? I haven't seen much of that. I haven't seen much of that at all. And yet you get football fans and fan channels like this and others who don't really get any access to the club. No, you know, you can't come into a press conference. We're not allowed into press conferences because they're not from Manchester. They're not from Manchester. He's a Forest fan. Flex is a Luton fan. They're not going in. Oh, it's outrageous. They've got them on Sky Sports. And yet, in these bloody press conferences, freebies, free tickets to loads of games, you've got all these media outlets, all these papers that everyone knows constantly spread shit about our players. They're in there. The club are inviting them in. Those people are out allowed in there. Where's the responsibility? Where's the accountability? You know, when's the message going to go out to these people that, you know what, you're in a bloody privileged position. You get access to our football club and our football players and press conferences, and you write shit about them, and yet the club still invite them in. You know, in Sir Alex Ferguson's day, if they treated Giggs like they've treated Greenwood, some of these outlets wouldn't even be in the press conference. I'm not talking about the journalist. I'm saying that journalist writes for you. He ain't coming on tour. That paper's not coming in the press conference. Do one. Where is Manchester United in this? Because everybody gets mad about the articles about Rashford's houses and the articles about Mason Greenwood. But why are the club not acting on it? Because you know why? I think I know why. I think it's because there's relationships there. And I don't think the club are leaking about Mason Greenwood or anything like that. But I think the club needs to grow a pair and stop this bullshit. Because ultimately, we are a football club and we need to protect our players. We need, you know, what if Mason Greenwood is really struggling? You're telling me Manchester United can't have a word with some of these journalists and say, look, hold up a bit. I know you've got stories to write and maybe some of your information is true, but I'm telling you now, if you keep going down this road, you ain't coming in the press conferences. And if you want to write about that, that's up to you, but we're a football club and we're going to look after our own. And you know what? We talk about a lack of consistency on the football pitch. It runs through the club like a stick of rock. Consistency, siege mentality, looking out for your own. There are too many rumours that come out of that club about dressing room issues, about lack of respect for people like Ed Woodward from the players, lack of respect from the owners, not liking the way players have been treated like Sergio Romero. That came out a few weeks ago, that many players in the United squad not happy with the club for how they treated Sergio Romero. There seems to be this disconnection between the players and the club. Well, how's about, hello, we are one football club. We want to be successful. Let's have a bit of camaraderie. Let's bring it all together. But look, I don't know what you think, but I was just thinking about it last night. It really pisses me off. It really pisses me off that I see it on social media every day. You, the fans, calling out these media outlets for going in on our players. And yet these same media outlets will be there on Friday asking our manager a question. Who's got the power to actually make this change? Because we as fans will just keep seeing these articles. Oh, there's another story about Greenwood here, another one here. The club has. And under Sir Alex Ferguson, this would not have happened as much. And I'll tell you another thing as well. I remember when I was at secondary school, I came into school the next day, we had English, and Cantona had done that kick. And these bloody, I don't know what, you know, these people who just want to moan about everything. There was these people in our class were moaning about, well, I think it's a disgrace, because the debate opened up by the English teacher. It's a bloody disgrace that Cantona's done that, the money's he's on. And I stood up and I said, hold on a minute. Eric Cantona is not paid loads of money to not kick a Crystal Palace fan. Eric Cantona has paid a lot of money to kick a bloody football. Don't start talking about Marcus Rashford buying houses or Eric Cantona kicking a fan and saying the money they get's ridiculous. They're paid a lot of money because there's a lot of money in football. Where should the money go to in football? It should go to footballers. Of course, a footballer being on 350k a week is ridiculous amounts of money in the context of the world we live in. But that money is in football. Sky, Adidas, everybody, they chuck loads of money into football because loads of people watch it. And of course, footballers should get it. What they do with that money is nobody's business. If Eric Cantona goes and kicks a fan because he gets abused, then he faces the ban that he got. It's got nothing to do with how much bloody money he gets paid. If Marcus Rashford wants to go and buy a street of £2 million houses, screw everybody else. It's very logical where he's got that money from. He's not gone out and nicked it, has he? He's one of England's most high-profile footballers, and he earns a lot of bloody money. What he does with it is up to him. And yet, these same outlets who dig at our players are invited in by the club and given information. And look, many of you lot are going to say, well, you know what? Darren Cox says, can never understand the British press, how they want to tear down young English players. Well, they can stick it. Greenwood's going to be a star. I agree with that. And bring back siege mentality. Only way to create a family feel at the club we have been lacking, says CB. But this comes from the bloody club. I'm telling you now, Sir Alex Ferguson, he used to ban journalists and media. You know, he didn't talk to the BBC. The BBC is probably one of the biggest institutions in the world. And actually, even today, is still a very credible outlet. He wouldn't talk to them. He wouldn't talk to them. Now, his reasons for that may seem a little bit petty, but he wouldn't do it. What do you think he'd do? What do you think Sir Alex Ferguson would do on Friday when he walks into a press conference and the press coordinator says to Sir Alex, oh, we've got a question from this news outlet and this journalist. No, I ain't doing that. You've seen what they leaked about Mason Greenwood last week. Yeah, but we've got a good relationship with them. Well, you haven't anymore. I ain't answering a question from him who's screwing about with my young lads and my team. Screw it. And that, the club need to do that, but they don't do that. They don't do that. And look, there's many of you people saying in the live comments saying, well, you know what? You're very critical of the players. Yeah, we are. You are as well. But I'm not critical of the players in relation to how many houses they buy, what car they drive. I'm critical of the players in relation to how they perform in a Manchester United shirt, and I'll never stop doing that because that is what they're paid to do. The money, the millions they get, the privilege they get is to wear a Manchester United shirt, which I and many of you would like to do. I will never, and you will never, stop watching a football match and saying they don't deserve to wear that shirt when they don't perform. When they do perform, they will get the praise. But this is the world we live in. And at the press that we're talking about is the one, the gutter press, basically. The ones that spread the rumours about our players and, you know, are targeting these players when I believe, and I'm sure many of you believe, that we should be looking out for these players because, that you know, some of them are very young and very impressionable and they're going to make mistakes. And the last thing we want is another player, which we've seen in the last few years, who is a great talent, who goes off the rails and never, ever, ever succeeds. And look, let's use Mason Greenwood. For me, I've always said he can be anything he wants to be at Manchester United. He can be an absolute superstar. And that is why he needs all the support and protection he needs. And I personally think Manchester United should be banning some of these media outlets who are writing about him because they need to get control of the situation. And people will say, well, you can't ban free press. Well, of course you can't, but you can stop answering bloody questions for them. We're not a bloody publicly listed company that has to, well, I think we actually, well, maybe we are, but my point is, we are not obligated to speak to every journalist and every news outlet. We can take control of that. And I just think there's a massive level of inconsistency when Manchester United are inviting these outlets and these journalists who follow us around, probably getting freebies all over the place, and yet they work for outlets that are digging up dirt on our players. There's a level of inconsistency there, and Manchester United can play a part on this because a lot of what's been written about Mason Greenwood is bullshit. We know it's bullshit because these journalists are writing this bullshit, and then Ole Gunnar Solskjaer is coming out and saying it's not happened. So, but then you're taking questions from that outlet. you know, if they're writing bullshit, don't give him anything. Don't invite him to a press conference. Ban him. You know, you'll soon sort it out. It's exactly what Sir Alex Ferguson would have done. We need to stop being, you know, so nice about this. You know, people's careers and lives are at stake here. And we need to start protecting these players. I've got no problem if Mason Greenwood plays against West Brom and plays trash. And everyone says, oh, I'm really worried about him. You know, he's playing shit. Then, you know, you can have an opinion on how he plays football. But it's going too far. And to me, it just feels at the moment like I can't imagine what it's like to be Mason Greenwood at the moment, because everybody knows it's a story. And, you know, you look at Foden. Foden's back in the England team. Now, I'm sure Foden, after what happened in Iceland, got his head down and, you know, not what happened in Iceland. I don't know what he did with his head there. But, you know, when he got back from Iceland, he's kept his head down. He's played a bit of football and that. But I personally still think that the press were more focused on Greenwood anyway, because he's the more high-profile player and he plays for Manchester United. But we'll see. Mark, I really do think the press has went to town on United. Maguire, Rashford, Greenwood, Solskjaer, Pogba, Bruno. It needs to stop. Pure jokes, says Shane O'Hare. Liverpool don't allow the sun in presses, says Joe Welsh. And Mark, we'd end up with no one in there, says Robert McCormack. Well, you know, I'm sure Ollie would prefer that. Dragging young black athletes into controversy is an easy way to sell papers. There are hateful people who can't wait to see them fail. Disgraceful, says Gustav. And hi, Mark. I think the press target United for their own benefit, says Mikhail Roche. I think both those comments are valid. I really do. I mean, unfortunately, again, it is, you know, Rashford, Mason Greenwood, Paul Pogba, you know, they're all young black athletes. But then again, you know, Harry Maguire isn't. And I think there is a lot of truth in what's been said there as well. But also, I think the Harry Maguire thing feeds into the other point, which also, not only is it young black athletes, it's Manchester United. Manchester United sell. That's the way it is. You know, if you're a journalist and you've got a story on, look, let's be honest, let's be really honest. Late last week, there is a story that comes out from, was it the Daily Mail, that a young Premier League footballer has been arrested on suspicion of a serious sexual assault. On that day, for the next 2 days, it was all about Mason Greenwood. And then another story came out saying that the player was in their 20s. So it couldn't be Mason Greenwood. What's happened since then? Is that story still being spoken about? Is it bollocks? Nobody's mentioning that story now. But if it had been a teenager, then it would have been, oh, it's got to be a Man United player. It's got to be Mason Greenwood who's done it. And that story would have bubbled and bubbled and bubbled and bubbled. But you know what? It's probably not a Manchester United player, because you know why I think it's not a Manchester United player? Because that story died as soon as it was revealed it was a Premier League player in their 20s. It's still a serious sexual assault, everybody. But, oh, it's not a Manchester United player now, so let's move on. Oh, look, Pogba said something innocuous again. Let's get on that. And that's the thing. I think not only is it, you know, young black athletes, and I think that there's definitely something there, and Raheem Sterling's mentioned this, and Kyle Walker's come out about it as well. I also think another massive part of this is it's Manchester United, and we saw that with Harry Maguire as well. And look, Harry Maguire's innocent until proven guilty, but it's Manchester United. If it's a Manchester United player, everyone's all over it. And I think Manchester United can play a part in this. When it comes to some of this stuff that's going on, then, you know, I think we've got to be very, very careful, because the personal stuff is not good. It's not good. If you're guilty of it, you're going to, you know, in any walk of life, you're going to have to face up to it. But the speculation around personal matters that goes on with Manchester United players, you know, and Rashford had it at the weekend with that article about his houses, and Greenwood's had it, and Maguire's had it, and Pogba gets it. There are things that Manchester United can do about this. And it just makes me laugh, because there is still this world where, you know, fan content, which is you, is sort of dismissed and, you know, well, don't let them in. But then the mainstream media, oh, come in, here's your freebie, here's your press pack. And yet, who's the more destructive? Is it fan channels and fan media that is all about, you know, we love the club, we want the club to be back where it is, we're very critical of the owners, we're very critical of the way we perform on the pitch, we're very critical of players? Or the mainstream media that doesn't really get that critical on the owners, because, oh, we might not get our press pass, But let's go in on personal life matters on the players. You know, I know which side of the fence I sit on because I present the United Stand, but to be honest, that's the side I want to be on. I want to be critical of the way the clubs run. I want to be critical of the way the players perform if they don't perform well enough. But the people who are inside the club and being invited to press conferences, they're the ones who aren't really that critical about the club and go in after the players' personal lives. Oh, I wonder why the Manchester United Football Club invite them in and they don't invite people like us in. Oh, is it because we're critical of the way you run the club and they're not? But that's by the by. My main issue is that actually, you know, these outlets are putting stuff out about our players, personal matters, you know, struggles. And I don't think that's acceptable. And I think more could be done by the club. At the end of the day, he's a kid. The club will support him as much as possible, but his success will be determined by his decisions, says Mark Perellas. Yeah, well, no, I disagree with that. I think that, you know, he's a kid and he needs to be supported by the club. He will make bad choices. Of course he will. Most youngsters do. But there is definitely ways of protecting him. And Manchester United have got the blueprint. Ryan Giggs, Lee Sharp, some of our youngsters, there's lots of stories about what they were up to. And Sir Alex Ferguson was all over it. You know, he kept stuff out of the press. He had good relationships with journalists. Do we live in a different world? Yes, we do. There was no Twitter. There was no, you know, phones and things like that. It is a lot harder now. But Manchester United can certainly keep a lot, you know, keep a lid on this a lot better, I think. And I think that, look, there's, who knows what the truth is with Mason Greenwood? Some would say there's no smoke without fire. But the reality is he's a fantastic talent. And, you know, the less that's out there in the press, the better. Because, you know, United, it's United's player to nurture and protect. And I think that things can be done better to do that. And I think that, you know, what we need to do is try and, you know, try and educate our press around these sort of things that, you know, if you want a superstar player, and a lot of us do, then, you know, going after this player all the time isn't helpful. But, you know, they will say, well, I'm happy with the source that I've got. You know, where is the source coming from? In the club, probably, as well. The big problem is we leak like a sieve as a football club. We're talking about transfers at the start of the video, but we leak like a sieve anyway. Team sheets, transfer news, what's going on in the training ground, disruption in the dressing room. This has been going on for years as well. The lack of lead, I could talk to you all day. We're not consistent as a football club. There's a disparity between the players and the club and a lack of trust. And there's a lack of leadership running through the club as well, which is why there's so much information gets leaked out. We are a mess as a football club. And, you know, I'm not going to go after individuals within that football club, but we are a mess. The too much information gets leaked out. And to me, that's weak leadership in that football club because, yeah, of course, there was leaks when Sir Alex Ferguson was there. But you got the impression that as soon as that was leaked, he'd find out where it was and that person wouldn't be in the club anymore. At United, it feels like, you know, if you try, it's like that cartoon, isn't it? You leak one, you use that finger, you use your groin, you use your toe, you use your head, you use your nose, you use your tongue. There's too many leaks. We should be trying to plug a lot of those leaks. I fear the way United runs the club has something to do with how they handle with the media stuff. Just look back at Woodward's comments before, says Genuel Belenderes. Yeah. Okay. Look, a bit of a moan, but sometimes I think a moan is, you know, is relevant, you know, because we're moaning a lot as a fans. You know, we're moaning about the way the media, I've seen a lot of people moaning about the media, and they're right over the last couple of days in relation to Rashford, in relation to, you know. And the sad thing is, Marcus Rashford calls out that Daily Mail article on Sunday, and then he's doing articles with The Sun and Sky Sports Today because he's promoting a good thing. And, you know, there's no doubt that the players have got to work with the press. I saw some people saying, well, what's he done an article with The Sun for? Well, because The Sun is quite a red, you know, it's quite a working class paper. I used to deliver papers when I was a youngster and, you know, I used to deliver papers in quite a working class area. And most people got The Sun and the Daily Mirror. So if you're Marcus Rashford and you're trying to appeal to, you know, parents of children who don't get access to books, actually doing an article with The Sun makes a lot of sense because it's read by a lot of people who he's trying to target. So, you know, we've got to work with the press. Of course we have as players, but also some of them, you know, They've got a free rein at the moment, and I think United could do a lot more. Anyway, thanks everyone for watching. Please smash a like on the video. Subscribe if you're new. Football for me should be about football. You know, critical of the way the clubs run, critical of the way the manager performs if he's not performing, critical of the way players are performing. If they're doing something off the pitch that, you know, directly impacts on how they play, if one of our players goes out and gets hammered on Friday night and, you know, spends a night in a brothel and, you know, turns up the pitch and plays terrible, then there's a direct link to that. And I get that. But it just feels to me that we're wandering down a dangerous path. And I'm very grateful and happy that when I look on social media, I see a lot of United fans who are calling this out now. I think the club needs to do a little bit more. That's all. Thanks for watching. Speak to you all in a bit. Oh, sorry. And also make sure you download the Flick app. You can vote on which centre-back you would prefer. Upamecano, Carmo or David Alaba. The link's in the video description. Get on there. We'll talk about it a bit later. You can chat on there as well. It's free and it's on Apple and Android. Link in the video description for that. Thanks for watching. Speak to you all in a bit.